get another day now. I am bored of this one, 'cause I've become a victim of an artist that you can't resist. He said, don't let go till I tell you so. Can we get another life now? 'Cause I am so bored of this one, so I live for you. Only for you.
Do you want my single name?
Yes, please.
And my single name was Dorothy Catherine Rose England. I was born in 104 Park Road North, South Acton. Go ballroom dancing, learning, top of Richmond Hill. I think it was Bob Clark and Eco's studio, but I'm not quite sure the name, if it was his. And when we was working, and in the early part of the stage of, we used to paint the black handles, and we used to stand there painting, and we practiced our heel turn, where we put the handles over.
I had a little train that used to run. I don't know where it started from, but it stopped at South Acton Station. Like, I think they called it, the girls there called it the Ginny.
Yeah, we used to get the Ginny from South Acton.
You used to go to Acton Town and backwards and forwards.
It's a little push-me pull, just a one-carriage train which ran from Acton Town to South Acton. That's all, and then back.
And that was because they had that there, because over Acton, over the lane, Bolo Lane, used to be the maintenance place for the railway. They used to mend all the railway parts there. George's dad worked there. So those men used to come through the alleyway from there and to get on the little ginny to get to the Acton Town Station.
It was on a high level. It came out of Acton Town Station at the level that is, carried on the same level over a bridge, which you'll see the parapets of still there before you come to the level crossing in Boller Lane. And it ended up at South Acton Station at a high level still, so you went down steps to get to the other.
What I remember hearing was it was like the wives and daughters of the brickworkers actually took in laundry as a way of, I suppose, supplementing the income, and that became the laundry, how the laundry industry started.
All the laundries closed down when all the washing machines started to come out, and most of all them laundries turned into little factories. With me, and I worked in one of them, and my youngest brother, he learnt the trade of, you know, inside the cars, Rolls Royce and all that, all the trimmings, he used to do all that.
Well, on the Acton angle, I came to London itself in 1952 from Dublin, and probably 58 through to when I went full-time with the union in 79. But on the Acton particular thing, there was an Acton Works, which was a major overhaul for all the London underground trains, and all the major overhaul and all the whole lot at Acton. Right? And it employed about 1,500 people there. and but there was so much industry. Acton was teeming. You name it. There was something from aircraft, right through to buses, to trains, the whole lot. Everything was done in engineering in the Acton area. The famous Napier's factory down the road, which was employed, has done a very skilled job on engines and a whole lot.
Yes.
CAVs, Lucas CAVs. Thousands literally piled onto buses and trains. And trade union was, it was very strong.
And of course, it was badly bombed here.
It was. Can you remember bombs?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. My brother and I used to sleep underneath the kitchen table.
Yeah.
And Dad done the coal cellar out.
Yeah.
Whitewashed it. Wasn't motion then. And the bombs were dropping then in Park Road North.
Very poignant to me is the Park Road bombing, Park Road North. Now this was South Acton Estate, and. It was unusual because actually it was after the Blitz and before the Doodlebugs, and it was a very big bomb explosion in May 1943 when not many bombs were falling.
All our windows caved in, and the top of Park Road North is Park Road East,
yeah.
And that used to be a dairy, and Mr. and Mrs. Lewis was killed by a bomb there.
It destroyed the Gladstone Public House, a street corner dairy, five other shops and four houses. That's a big bomb to do that. You know, it wasn't just one in the house or whatever.
My dad's mum, she worked in lavender laundries in Stratford Road. And obviously, all I know about them is when the summer came, they all used to have a day out and go down to the seaside and get dressed up and goodness knows what else. And I believe they used to haunt Ramsgate in those days. It was Ramsgate and Margate. Everybody used to go to Ramsgate. I don't know why. Maybe it was nice back then, I don't know. But it was never Southend or Brighton or anything like that. Mm-hmm.
And the accordion playing, so that's your...
My dad.
Your dad on these same trips.
My dad, yeah.
So...
He learnt to play this. He took classes. I've got the card somewhere of the teaching part of it anyway. And he paid £17.50 for 2.5 years. And this was, I think I've got another bit somewhere of when he learnt to play the accordion. And obviously there was a method in his madness because, yeah, he used to take all these women out on their trips out to the seaside and that, and play for them all day, all the way down and all the way back, and they bought his beer, and he made a bit of money to take me out later on as I came along.
Yeah, the Venture Playground was really good because we took a lot of things from these back-to-back houses that have been, where people had been taken out of. And so they built all kinds of towers and all kinds of things. What was good really was the when they used to make these towers, they'd make two towers and then have a rope, so you swung from one platform to another.
Oh, wow.
I mean, you can't do that now because of health and safety. one day my dad went over there and he said, "What's going on?" He said, "He was down there. He couldn't even see their heads. They were digging a hole for this telegraph pole to put the telegraph pole in."
Yeah.
He said, "Get out of there, get out of there." They had there was no support on the shaft at all.
Yeah.
All he could see was these heads.
Yeah, it was quite packed with houses. They were all like two up, two down type places. And they were apparently built just after the war because of all the bombing that occurred in London. So they moved a lot of people out and rehoused them in South Acton especially. I don't know what was there before, but when I was born, there was a lot of industry started up to try and get England back to where it used to be.
We moved here in August
six and a half years ago?
2007, August 2007, yeah.
And what did you come to do?
Randy came to be the associate
vicar of the parish, Anglican parish of Acton Green. And this is my clergy house we live in.
And can you tell me something about the changes that you've seen in that time? Acton has changed a lot.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, you only have to walk out of the door because obviously the whole estate is being regenerated as part of sort of wider scheme. And I mean, the block next to us, Kane House, is now empty, vacant. Across the road, Carroll Court is emptying out. I think Graham is emptying, Graham House, emptying, isn't it?
Yeah.
So there's been a huge change. People who were neighbours have gone and have moved either out to the new places or moved out of the area altogether. I mean, including members of our own congregation. I mean, like Connie and John have moved from Connor. Is it Connor? On the end?
Yes.
Down to the new blocks.
Yes, and they were in their flat for about
and Janet.
And Janet Disso, again. Yeah. Who has moved into the new blocks.
Yeah.
What do you think of the feelings of people who've had their lives changed?
It's been a really difficult process, actually, and in a way, I think it's inevitably going to be like that, because, I mean, as we were saying, some people have been here since the places were built. Mm-hmm. One of our elderly parishioners, Joyce, who is now in a residential facility in Perivale, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, she'd been in her flat forever, and it was quite difficult for her to actually understand what it was that they were asking her to do.
Yes.
And I think there's been a whole history of misinformation.
I mean, we've been here 6.5 years, and actually when we got here, the regeneration process had stalled badly.
Yeah.
It had stalled several times. I think something was happening when we got here, but that all went wrong. And, you know, and there was an awful air of impermanence, but without anything positive. And I think the fact that it really is being regenerated now has actually cheered everybody up, you know.
Yeah.
It might make you feel a bit very insecure in your house. I mean, we're beginning to feel that in this house, because this house will go at some point. Yeah. But at least, you know, there is a sort of plus to it.
Projects like this and what the arts forum and the community forum are doing. It is because it's very easy for the whole history of an area to become obliterated.
Yes.
And I mean, Vic Ashmore, who's an elderly member of our congregation, he has photographs of Osborne Road with the old houses, you know, the old terraced houses. And all those kind of memories can very easily get lost, particularly when you're having a regeneration which is not only changing the structure of the area in terms of the buildings and the architecture, but it's actually changing the character of the area. You bet I don't play. Just land a big jet on the runway. Can you give it to me all night, all day? Hey, now Cecilia, what about say what I've been going through? Let's one back a name like an F1 review. But wait till it does to get a hold of you. In the bedroom, you start calling me sucker soon. You think I'm cute, boy? Can you do the hook? Looking for a root, boy? Let your arms up.
Well, moving in South Acton, age of 11, my brother Lyndon, mum and dad. It was interesting. It was very quiet, you know, coming to the estate. But you know, living in South Acton, it was very interesting because certain places you couldn't go, and that was like deep in South Acton. I remember there was a place called the Crown Pub. We was not allowed to go. When I say we, as in black people, couldn't go past there. You know, them times there was National Front, mods, things like that. You know, It was hard for us to go down there and stuff like that, especially if you had school and things like that. I remember Braemead School was down there and stuff like that. You know, I remember, you know, hearing stories, you know, certain people go down there, you know, and they'd be jumped by maybe, you know, 10 white youths and stuff like that.
South Acton used to be a very British national controlled area.
In the late 70s, the National Front were very active locally, and they used to stand in the local elections and spout slogans and in the high street, and they'd be delivering leaflets through the doors.
So whenever we went through here, there was always problems. We always had to run, fight, there was bots thrown, car chases, that sort of thing.
There were a lot of slogans appearing, being painted on walls on the South Acton estate, and also where I used to walk up Acton Lane, there was a railway bridge with a sort of passageway at the side, and that had a lot of racist slogans painted on it too. So we decided at one point to have a paint out on the South Acton estate and paint out these slogans, and you know, come along with our paint brushes and paint them over, because the council in those days didn't do much about them. You know, there wasn't this, you couldn't call up someone now from environment and they'd come out. And when we did this, the police turned up, and obviously they'd been tipped off by someone, and a group of young, rather aggressive, not very nice National Front people turned up and started goading us and shouting, and we were trying to ignore them and trying to paint this out. And then one young man in our group lunged at them, and they took that as the opportunity for a general fracas, you know, and a fight started to break out. So I sort of stepped back. And at that point, the police sort of made a move to come in. But instead of arresting the National Front guys or even someone from the guy from our side who'd started it, they seized this rather tubby guy. And obviously he was easy to get hold of. They wanted someone to arrest, I think, you know, and that was the reason why. So they arrested him, and I heard later he was actually being charged. I couldn't believe it. I thought, oh, you know, they must be mad. He wasn't really involved. So I offered to be the witness, a witness for him. He had a couple of others as well. And we all duly went along to Acton Magistrates Court one time. And I went up there and, you know, said what I had seen and all the rest of it. The other people gave evidence as well, and pleased to say that he got off. So he was very pleased about it, and you know, the right thing had turned out actually. I think in the end enough of us sort of made a stand, and that, you know, that was the reason why the National Front went. It was, you know, people of all races getting together and saying we don't want that sort of thing. So there's still racism, but at least we managed to see off the National Front.
I moving here, I catch the last snippet of that. You understand? That change. Mm-hmm. You understand? So when things start to, whenever the clouds start to go and the more sunshine is, it's like people start to change and their mentality start to change. And then all of a sudden you just see people playing cricket, we're playing runouts, things like that. Everybody's mingling, and you can actually, at the time you didn't see the change, but looking at it now, you can say, okay, wow, you can actually see everybody come together. And
looking at it now, the kids of today will never experience what I had, because they took away all those small little houses, they ruined it, and they stuck up all those tower blocks.
They were there, and you know, you got a lot of people into them, but they're not very friendly places to live. You know, you throw everybody into one spot, and you were always in each other's face.
Your front doors were all in corridors.
Yes. Yeah, because it was on the third floor. They had a lift in the centre, that went up. But, you know, because of these corridors, it was quite frightening at night.
It's when they built the new flats, they obviously thought it was a good idea, but you never knew who was hanging around.
No, there could be anybody hanging about. Yeah. No,
it began. It was going to say it was began to get a bit. You weren't sure of people then, whereas when you were in the proper streets, you did.
We had people that we knew that were opposite, and people downstairs which were friendly, but it wasn't the same. It wasn't the same atmosphere at all.
No.
Why do you think that is?
Well, I think it was just the community feeling. You come from where you knew everybody. And you felt you could just go and knock on anybody's door. Whereas, you know, once you shut your door and you're in this closed-in corridor, it's not the same as living in a street.
No.
My name's Leon Joseph. I'm a regeneration officer who works for Ealing Council. My main project is South Acton Estate. One of the biggest buildings that used to be on this estate had, let's say, about 100 homes. And it's the first building of significance to, I'd say, be vacated in Ealing for quite some time. I made sure I was the very, very last person in there before we closed the doors. And I got my iPod out, put some music on, and walked around the whole building from top to bottom. And I couldn't believe how emotional I actually felt. But it was happy. The reason I was happy is because I had some Stevie Wonder on playing some excellent music, which brought to mind the excellent job that I thought we had done, because I don't work on my own, I work as part of a team, that I thought we had done, I thought the residents had been part of, and this was a new start.
Changes, I think I'm actually kind of looking forward to it, definitely. You know, Acton Gardens, you know, I've got a picture of it, and, you know, hopefully it will change certain people's minds. I'll hopefully be more of a community again, more of that love coming back again, you know. So, yeah, that should be very interesting, you know. You know, I mean, walking down where Bolabrook is, the new flats, and I just walk, even the atmosphere, it seems peaceful. Like, okay, it's different, okay, you know, new blocks and everything, and people smiling, there's that little playground there by the park, everybody's happy, and that's how it used to be up here, you understand? So this change will be very interesting, definitely.
I would probably say Acton is very colourful, very diverse place to live to, and it has developed years after year, and probably 10 years ago here in Acton you wouldn't have a lot of hope. You would say, I would like to move away from Acton, but I think now Acton become a bit more affluent place and people are moving to Acton, and now we're getting to new train lanes in Acton and in Mayo. So hopefully it would be one of the hot places in London. Mm-hmm. As Shepherd, which is next to Acton, is becoming one of the most likable places to live in London or in in the UK. So hopefully Acton will follow that trend, and there is a huge developments going on in the state and across the world. Yeah. So hopefully, I would not change any of our act, to be honest. Mm.
Yep, I was born in 1962 and was born as Lubna Ikram. So very much born and bred in Acton, almost, and certainly educated in Acton, went to Maples Nursery, and then to Priory Infants, then to Berrymead Junior School, after Berrymead Junior School to Walpole Grammar School, and then on to university, and so on and so on. But spent the vast majority of my life in Acton, and saw it through its many changes.
And now you're the head teacher.
It's bizarre. Bizarre because I had my memories of being here as a child, and then when I arrived here as an adult to do an interview as a deputy head, then it was very surreal. The school looked surprisingly very, very similar to the way I remembered it. And one thing I found very odd, that in the hall there was a display right above the hall where you can't really reach on a day-to-day basis, and it's the same display I have in my photographs as a child, which I thought was really funny. So, I changed those after a while. And I do also remember, towards the latter years, bulldozers. So flattening the land just prior to the school where those houses were. And there were just mounds of earth everywhere and just bulldozers all over the place. And as children, we used to sort of run over them and, you know, probably not doing health and safety wasn't quite what it is now. Running in and out of bulldozers, you know. I remember losing my ring then, thinking, oh my God, my mother's going to kill me because I lost the ring and couldn't find it. But the other very naughty thing we used to do, Barry House, a sort of 20-floor block of flats, just it's gone now. There are other flats there. We used to, as thrill seekers, go to the top floor and peer over the balcony. Now, can you imagine our children doing that today? I just think, you know, awful. And dare each other to go and see if you could go right over the edge and really peek over the edge and, you know, that sort of thing. So, yeah, I'm a bit of a risk taker then as well. I just think the time, it was a very happy time. It was a very, very carefree time. And one thing that my own children cannot even begin to imagine or conceptualize is the fact that the street that I lived on, everybody's door was wide open. And we left the house early in the morning, and our parents hadn't got a clue where we were for the next 12 hours. We would come home late at night, scruffy, filthy, but having the best time of our lives, and often leaving our bikes and things in the park, and it would still be there the next morning. So they cannot visualise or conceptualise what that was like, and the fact that we were in and out of each other's houses without any door knocking. Mm. And we had a very mixed street in terms of people. Yes, and it was a very, very happy time, very carefree time. And I think a far more caring time where actually neighbours knew, you actually knew who your neighbours were.
Media of Acton, I know definitely in the 1920s, there was some Muslims here.
Where were they from?
Which one person was a famous Quran translator, Abdul Majid Sawali, and believe it or not, he was staying on the Avenue. but then obviously fast forward a bit, then you come to 1946, you had the Olympics at Wembley Stadium, and you had Acton High School. It closed early for 1 week as it became an Olympic village for the Pakistani team and the Iraqi and Iranian team. And they were doing the prayers there, they had to have our food there. They had a couple of chefs that came from a 1920s restaurant in Regent Street as well, setting down some of the local ladies there as well. Thank you.
South Acton, I suppose, has always been at least dealing in one of West London's biggest estates.
It's one of the largest estates in Western Europe.
Yeah. And it'll always be South Acton for many people.
Yeah, I think so.
So we've seen lots of positive things that happen, that sort of community activity.
But I have a feeling that if it had gone on with the policy of simply putting people into effectively emergency accommodation from everywhere for every reason, that it would soon have become individual isolation of people with no common interests, no common heritage, no common background even, just put there because they needed housing. That is the way to wreck a community. I think it's appropriate that I deal with something as mundane as this for the benefit of the housing associations. They must ensure that maintenance is regular and that repairs are dealt with. Their people should not be reduced to the circumstances that they were living in the council stock.
Yes, initially lived down a road, down part of Acton Lane, Petersfield Road, and then moved up into North Acton for a while. Okay, became neighbours with Tipper. All right, families got well integrated. Okay, and virtually moved at the same time down here into South Acton, around 78, 79, something like that. And that was it.
So what are your strongest memories of growing up around here then?
Around here, a lot of the time, it was like you said, we had a good community. We did. I mean, we knew each other. I mean, once everyone moved in and got to know each other, we're in each other's pockets, more or less. And even though we had different races, ethnicities, most people just got on. We didn't have much trouble. They wasn't that way orientated. Everybody was out to just live a life, have a bit of fun, and we generally had a laugh together. Okay? And like he did express, there was a stigma between living in this estate and being part of South Acton. That's where we drew the borderline at Avenue Road. Anything south of Avenue Road was their territory. Up here, we were more sophisticated. We were here in red brick, yeah? New estate, we were nice. That's it.
Big
words, yeah, you know. I'll give you the spellings later. I'll give you the spellings later, yeah? Alright, mate? You can get them later.
So we're ready to roll, I think.
Twist and turn, who will burn tortured heart? You feel it fine to deny what's so clear. Stop mumbling, 'cause fear of life ain't kind. and breathe your decline. Even though